Hello everyone, Sanket here. Last time we saw what exactly in the last video we saw what exactly is what are the various data sources for your immunology, why exactly we have to carry out immunoinformatics. In this we'll be looking at what are the various immunomic tools in the algorithms, what is there. So your antigen, all right, it binds to the various corresponding antibodies, and this binding of your antigen to the corresponding antibodies is called as your antigen's antigenicity. All right, when these similar antigens induce some sort of an immune response, okay, then what we call is called as immunogenicity. Okay, so you understood what is antigen's antigenicity and what is immunogenicity. Our whole purpose of developing the tools and algorithms is to predict this epitope. Now, epitope prediction helps in your antigen's antigenicity and immunogenicity. Now, what is the purpose of your epitope? Is basically to design a molecule, okay, which can replace your antigen, and it can bind to your corresponding antibodies, and it can carry out both these actions. Okay, it's to design a molecule which can replace your antigen, and it binds to your corresponding molecule, and it can carry out antigen's antigenicity and immunogenicity. So the purpose for actually designing a molecule such as this is A, it is not expensive, okay, and second, it is non-infectious like your viruses, okay, or the bacteria with which we can which we make attenuated vaccines, you know. So if we can actually come up with something which can do all the properties of what your antigen can, that is what is the purpose of carrying out epitope production. And what will be the purpose of this epitope? Okay, it is to carry out the following things. One is to see how the disease mechanism work. Second is to understand the host and the pathogen interaction and study its analysis. Basically, this is what we call as your protein-protein interaction. Then antimicrobial target discovery, and last is your vaccine design. So this is the reason or the purpose for carrying out your epitope production. Now there are various ways, okay, or tools with which we can carry out this prediction. The first way or the prediction mechanism is your B cell epitope prediction. Okay, so what exactly are your B cells? Your B cells are or your B cell epitopes, okay, I'll call it that way. If you want to determine this B cell epitope experimentally, number one, it is very much time consuming. Second, it is very, very expensive. So that's why we come up with computational methods in order to predict your B cell epitopes. Okay, so your B cell epitopes, what do they do? They are antigenic determinants which are present on the surface of the pathogen. Okay, and they interact with your BCR. Now BCR are nothing but your B cell receptors. Okay, so what are the various ways in which your B cell receptors can be predicted? The first one is your sequence-based method. So in your sequence-based methods, what we look, what we study are all those epitopes which are present on the surface. Okay, once we study the sequence, the epitopes which are present on the surface, it will give us a clear picture, okay, of how to predict a new epitopes, okay, and this has been successfully studied in influenza A or something. So this is your first one, which is your sequence based. Second is your amino acid propensity. As the name suggests, amino acid propensity, that means the number of amino acids which are present in a particular protein sequence. Amino acid propensity study has been used as a parameter in a number of occasions. If you're considering machine learning or any of those, amino acid propensity has been widely used. So if you, amino acid propensity, hydrophobicity, okay, ASA, that is your accessible surface area, all of these propensities have been hugely or widely studied, basically, polarity and all of these things. So, second way in which you can predict your B cells is by carrying out studying the amino acid propensity. Third ones are your machine learning methods. Now, I won't go into details of your machine learning methods, but all your supervised and unsupervised learners, okay, SVM, ANN, HMM, hidden Markov models, all of these models have been successfully used, okay, in order to study your B cell prediction model. So there has been number of classification methods which have been developed, which can help us to classify between those which belong to B cell epitopes and those which are not. The next one is your MIMO-TOP based method. All right, so what exactly is MIMO-TOP? I think it is, you must have not heard about it, because it is very specific, unlike your machine learning or amino acid or sequence base, which are used in a number of computational approaches or in silico approaches. This is very specific to your immunoinformatics. So your phage display methods, if you have known. So phage display library, all right, it's widely used for finding your protein-protein interactions, as especially in this case, when I'm talking about protein-protein interactions, I'm talking about antigen and antibody interactions. So, and why you need to find this antigen-antibody interactions or protein-protein interactions? In order to study the function, the identification, and most importantly is for development of new drugs and your vaccines. There was this paper by Pizzi et al. He proposed a new type of approach, okay, for mapping this B cell epitopes, in which this same phage display library, which is there, okay, it can be scanned against a desired antibody to obtain something what we call as a MIMO-TOPs. Okay, so you have this phage display library, it is being scanned against a desired set of, so you have a phage display, is display it is scanned against a antibodies to obtain a single what we call as a MIMO-TOP. And this MIMO-TOP, what is so special about it? It can bind with high affinity to the antibody. All right, so what we assume that this panel of MIMO-TOPs, okay, it mimics the physiochemical properties, alright, which is similar to how your antigens or your epitopes actually work. Now, if you see the name, it's called as MIMO-TOPs, okay. So, MIMO-TOPs, that means miming of the epitopes. So you understood why is it called as a why there is this word called as mime in it, because it is miming your epitopes. Okay, so it is possible, all right, that your MIMO-TOP can have some information about your epitope. But there is one important point which you have to see in when you are developing this MIMO-TOP, or when this MIMO-TOP is actually developed, that the homology or the miming, okay, it does not exist between the epitope of the native antigen and your MIMO-TOP. So if you look at the structure wise, if you want to look at the homology, there is no there is nothing similar in it. It is only similar, or it is only mimicking its physiochemical properties and yours and the spatial organization. Okay, are your five methods for your B cell prediction. The next approach is, it's called as a hybrid. Now, as the name suggests, it's a hybrid. So, hybrid meaning there is a ensemble or a mixture of two or more methods. Okay, so something like machine learning and amino acid coming together to come up with a much better prediction model, or a sequence based and machine learning coming together to develop a much better prediction model. That's why it's called as a hybrid prediction model. So these are the six important methods for prediction of your B cell. You have sequence based, amino acid propensity, machine learning, MIMO-type based, and hybrid prediction methods. So the current challenge in immunological prediction softwares which are currently present is to predict interacting molecules, okay, to a higher degree of accuracy. The most popular methods which are currently available, they are based on the binding affinity predictions for a range of your MHC molecules which is present. It is necessary to bind your antigenic peptides with the MHC so that the cytotoxic T cells, okay, which are there, they can recognize them. Thus, what is important is the identification of this MHC binding peptides plays a very important or a central role in the algorithm, okay, which is predicting your T cell epitopes. So there are a lot of methodologies which are currently present in order to predict your T cell epitopes. One being your matrix driven method. So all of you must have heard of BLOSSOM. BLOSSOM is basically a scoring matrix which is also used in prominently used in BLAST. That is your BLOSSOM 62 scoring matrix. So how the BLOSSOM 62 scoring matrix works is you have a matrix which has various scores for each and every amino acid. Similarly, in this case, there was a matrix which you can develop, okay, which has scores for your different amino acids. Okay, now the difference between your BLOSSOM and your this method is the BLOSSOM is specifically for your different scoring for your carrying out sequence alignment. In this method, one of the tool which we call as MMBPred, okay, what it does is it has its own scoring system which is there. So both of them follow the same concepts, but the scoring systems which is applied in both is different. So this is your matrix driven method. Second is your hidden Markov model based method. So when I'm talking about your hidden Markov model based methods is or your HMM method. So what is hidden Markov model is that it predicts the next event based on the current present event what time. So for example, what is going to happen tomorrow, okay, that is the next event, will be completely based on my current event, like what time today. So my tomorrow is completely based on what I am today. So in this case, it helps us to predict what are the different amino acids which will be present in your epitope region. Okay, so this is your HMM based prediction on your T cell. Third is your ANN or the artificial neural network. So artificial neural network is another important neural network which is a part of your machine learning. Okay, like in your previous B cell prediction which was there, it was one of the method, if you would have seen, was machine learning. Now when I'm saying machine learning, sab kuch aata hai. All of things is there. So you have SVM, you have ANN, everything in there. This in your T cell prediction, there's only specific, which is your artificial neural network method. What is that? Now your artificial neural network completely predicts, it completely mimics your biological neural network. Okay, so you have to have some input nodes and there is some hidden nodes. And there are weights which are applied to each and every different nodes which is there. Okay, and based on this, you have your ANN what is present. Okay, the next one is your structure based prediction method. Now, in your structure based prediction method, what it does is it already has predicted three-dimensional structures of your various MHC binding proteins which is there. And based on this various MHC binding proteins, it predicts your T cell epitope. What is it? So This is what is structure based, something very much similar to your homology modeling, but in this case it has already predicted 3D structures of your MHC proteins. So these are the four different prediction methods when we want to predict T cell epitopes. You have matrix driven, you have hidden Markov model, that is HNE, then you have ANN, that is artificial neural network, and last is your